37% of games bought on Steam have not been played. That means 1 in every 3 games, you are throwing away your money. And it's not just PC gamers, even console gamers do this too. We buy games thinking we're going to play them, but we don't. Why do we do this? Why do we waste our hard-earned money on games we don't even press start on? It all comes down to a few shockingly simple psychological tricks that Steam has perfected over the years, but first, let's take you back to a simpler time, your childhood. When we were kids, our lives were a lot easier and we had a lot of free time and little to no stress. That meant that any game we had was able to be played to completion with no worries about bills, societal expectations, anxiety, depression, or anything else that can get in the way of us and our virtual world. But maybe you didn't get that lucky and you used games as an escape from your situation at home. Either way, as we get older, we just have less time to play games than when we were little and more real life responsibilities that get in the way of us not only playing games, but also enjoying them too. When I was younger, I would just put Super Smash Bros. Or Fire Emblem into my GameCube and play for hours and hours. Even going into middle school and part of high school, I could hop on Destiny or NBA 2K after school from the time I got home and play games until it was time to eat dinner, shower, and go to bed. Today, even if I want to play a game, I have to plan out when I'm going to do it, and I also think about the opportunity cost of what I could be doing if I wasn't playing the game. Not to mention, playing a game after a long day of school or work is a lot less enticing when you're constantly tired or have your grades or bills to worry about. Part of the reason why we buy games that we'll never play is because we think it will give us that feeling that we got from gaming when we were kids. And to be fair, every once in a while, I do feel like I get that from a game. For example, last year I played Elden Ring with all of my friends for hours on end, trying so hard to beat bosses, playing PvP duels against each other, and exploring a new world together from night until morning. It was amazing, and the memories I made will last me a lifetime. But for the most part, a lot of the games we buy will never fill that old spark we had with gaming because we're just at a different point in our lives than where we used to be. Many of us also like the freedom of being able to do whatever we want with our money now that we're older and more mature, and one of those things is spending unjustifiable amounts of money on video games. The pain of not being able to buy a game you really wanted when you were younger is a common thing a lot of young gamers go through, having to wait for months on end for either Christmas or your birthday to get that new game you really wanted. And when you got it, you played it like it was the only game that existed, and most of the time, you beat it or at least got a lot of hours out of that game. Now that we have a little bit of money, and I'm speaking for myself when I say a little bit, we can get that new game whenever we want if we really want to. And for games that we're semi-interested in, we tell ourselves that we're being responsible with our money by waiting for a sale, or that we're saving money on games we want by buying them in a humble bundle. We tell ourselves, this bundle comes with 6 games for only $12. Now we'll have games to play for a month or maybe even longer. But what ends up happening is we add the games to our library and never get around to playing more than maybe 1 or 2 of them. Why does this happen? Well, the most obvious answer is because when we buy bundles, we're usually only interested in 1 or 2 of the games, but we'll still add the other games to our library, which makes us feel obligated to play them or even guilty for not playing them because we already paid for them. The other culprit is insane Steam sales that discount games for 60, 70, and even up to 90% off the retail price, which gets us excited about picking up games for a steal. I mean, at that point, you feel like if I don't buy the game for 80% off, how much more of a discount can I really wait for? If I don't buy it now, I'll end up buying it later, but the only difference is that if I want to play it between now and then, I won't be able to. Might as well add it to cart. And it's not like Steam doesn't know this already. We all love sales, but Valve loves them even more because it makes us feel like we're saving, not spending. If you ask someone how much they spent on a shopping spree, they probably wouldn't know, but ask them how much they saved from discounts and sales, and they'll tell you they saved a fortune. Steam has perfected its sales tactics by using a few very powerful yet sneaky sales techniques that have made them literally billions of dollars. 1. Steam uses the rule of 100. The rule of 100 states that a percentage discount is more appealing to consumers for items under $100, like seeing an 85% off discount on a game, and a dollar off discount works better for items priced over $100, like getting $400 off a $2,000 laptop is more enticing than just hearing 20% off, even though they're getting the same deal. The reasoning behind this is from a principle in psychology known as framing. Steam discounts their games using a percentage instead of the dollar amount because it will sound better to say that a game is 80% off instead of just saying that you're saving $20 off of a $25 game. 2. Steam uses the scarcity mindset against you. Most of us have heard of having an abundance mindset. This is the opposite. And when it comes to digital game keys, they can literally make infinite copies of a game software. So how do companies get you to buy? Flash sales. Flash sales create a sense of urgency. Buyers know deals will only be available for a limited time, which means that they feel the need to take action right away instead of waiting. If they don't, they'll have to pay full price later as a result. Steam highlights the percentage discount and when the sale ends to get you to feel that strong sense of urgency. This is also known as FOMO, the fear of missing out. And FOMO is a powerful tactic that's used on millions of consumers. 3. Have you ever wondered why most things we buy end in 99 cents? It's because of a simple trick that basically says that our brains consider the first first number of a price tag more important than the subsequent numbers, so seeing something that is $49.99 seems a lot cheaper to us than just saying $50. Hearing or even reading $50 just has some extra weight to it. Even though it seems illogical because we all know it's only a penny, this sale tactic works so well that almost every brand uses it. By discounting their games and having set seasonal sales like the winter and summer sales, it'll let gamers build up anticipation for those events, and then the floodgates of impulse buying and hoarding will start rolling in. Sometimes buying a game and adding it to your library can be more fun than actually playing the game itself. But if the game is that bad, you probably shouldn't do it though. As gamers, we've been wired to become collectors. Whether it was collecting all the Pokemon in the Pokedex or getting every achievement in a game, we've been taught that completing a collection is good, and there's almost always a reward right around the corner for doing it. The same psychology is used when it comes to buying games on Steam. We see a game, want to add it to our collection, we buy it with the idea that the reward of lots of fun is on the other side of our credit card details, and bam, the game starts installing immediately. If you're someone like me who started out as a console gamer and as you got older made the switch to PC, you might be tempted to rebuy games you already own on your Xbox or PlayStation that you don't have on your PC. Part of this is because now that we're gaming on PC, we tell ourselves that we may want to relive that game again, and all of the glory that PC gaming has to offer with higher refresh rates, new peripherals, and high resolution goodness. We also see our old consoles collecting dust and think that going to use it just to play one game is a lot of work. We have that fear of losing it in a sense, since it's no longer part of our current gaming library. You get tempted and you go ahead and purchase it again with the hopes of giving it a second go sometime in the future. But again, we never get to the actual part of playing the game. Why do we not play our games? Well, to start, have you ever actually taken a look at all of the games in your library and scrolled from top to bottom, and then bottom to top, and then do it over and over again? You try to find the perfect game to fit your mood, but you can't decide on what to pick. This is actually stemming from a phenomenon known as decision paralysis, and it's applicable to other areas of your life as well, not just gaming. Netflix also has this issue. You want to watch something on Netflix, but sometimes you spend more time looking for something to watch than actually watching a show. It's because while having options is good, having too many options can be not so good, and it can make you feel overwhelmed and not know what to pick. This is the paradox of choice, and it comes from two main things: decision paralysis and buyer's remorse. A classic example of decision paralysis comes from a famous experiment from 2000 known as the Jam experiment. It found that more people purchased Jam when fewer options were available. In the first trial, 24 options of Jam were available, and only 3% of shoppers bought the Jam. In the second trial, only 6 choices of Jam were available, and 30% of shoppers bought the Jam, leading to a 10 times multiplier in the number of shoppers buying Jam. Since this experiment, other studies supporting this phenomenon have also been published, but the main idea here is that less is more, meaning owning more games to play doesn't equal more games actually getting played. In fact, owning less games may even lead to you playing more games, since your choices become more clear. It's counterintuitive and crazy, I know. Now, let's talk about buyer's remorse. The more options that are available to you, the more you'll be left wondering if another option might have been better. After buying a game or even playing a game, you might be wondering if you could have bought something else that you would have liked more, or even played a game that you would have enjoyed more. Another thing to think about is, when we do have the time to play a new game, many of us get the urge to play that same old game that we've always played. Whether it's Dota, League, Valorant, Fortnite, Call of Duty, or CSGO, a lot of us have our bread and butter game that we play with our friends or by ourselves. There's a sort of mental barrier behind starting a new game that we sometimes can put on ourselves, as opposed to going with something we already know that we like. Other games just take up our time and pull us away from those that we haven't tried. Many of us can only play one or two games at a time, especially when it comes to AAA titles, because there is a lot to keep up with between gameplay mechanics, storylines, personal goals, inventory management, large open worlds, and everything in between. Sometimes you really do have the intention of playing your backlog, but each game just has so much to do that it feels like you've picked up a part-time job instead of playing a game that you truly enjoy. There are also games you buy for specific occasions, like to play with a friend, but then your schedules never line up and then you end up not playing them. For example, the Jackbox Party Pack series. These games are great to play with friends, and maybe you had a great time playing it once when you had some friends come over, so you decide to buy another pack, but you never end up playing it because your friends never show up, or at least they haven't yet. Moving on, a huge aspect of the gaming industry is the marketing of games, which can make us feel like we need to buy a game and that we're missing out on something if we don't. Have you ever seen a trailer for a game that got you super hyped up? You watch it and you're like, wow, this looks amazing. I need to get it. But then you get the game and you're like, eh, it's not as good as I thought it would be. This happens because marketing is designed to make you feel like you need to buy something. It highlights the best parts of a game and it makes it seem like it's going to be the best thing ever. They do this by using flashy trailers, stunning graphics, and endorsements through review ratings. All 10 out of 10s, right? And it's not just big budget games that do this. Even indie games use marketing to generate hype. They'll release a trailer and show off some cool mechanics or unique art style, and you're like, I've never seen anything like this before. I need to try it out. And it feels good to support the little guy, especially with all these AAA titans pumping out games nowadays. So you open up Steam and buy an indie game dev's new game, all for the price of a cup of coffee. Between marketing, seasonal sales, bundles, and real life responsibilities, it seems like we're doomed to always have an abundance of games to play with not enough time to play them all. It's not a bad problem to have, all things considered. Some of us know about at least a few of these tactics, but still buy games anyways. Maybe we're part of the problem. But hey, if you made it to the end, comment bundle, let me know your thoughts down below since I read every single comment, and thanks for watching.